Gilead Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Path, Accelerating Your Journey to Financial Freedom by Peter Mallouk with Tony Robbins, narrated by Peter Mallouk with Tony Robbins. Publisher's note, this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All figures referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. This book is designed to provide information that the authors believe to be accurate on the subject matter it covers, but it is sold with the understanding that neither the authors nor the publisher is offering individualized advice tailored to any specific portfolio or any individual's particular needs, or rendering investment advice or other professional services such as legal, tax, or accounting advice. A competent professional's services should be sought if one needs expert assistance in areas that include investment, legal, tax, and accounting advice. This publication references performance data collected over many time periods. Past results do not guarantee future performance. Additionally, performance data, in addition to laws and regulations, change over time, which can change the status of the information in this book and do not reflect the deduction of management fees or other expenses. This book solely provides historical data to discuss and illustrate the underlying principles. Additionally, this book is not intended to serve as the basis for any financial decision, as a recommendation of a specific investment advisor, or as an offer to sell or purchase any security. Only a prospectus may be used to offer to sell or purchase securities, and a prospectus must be read and considered carefully before investing or spending money. No warranty is made with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the information contained herein, and both the author and the publisher specifically disclaim any responsibility for any liability, loss, or risk, personal or otherwise, which is incurred as a consequence, directly or indirectly, of the use and application of any of the contents of this book. All examples used throughout this book are for illustrative purposes only. In the text that follows, many people's names and identifying characteristics have been changed. Legal disclosure. Rankings and or recognition by unaffiliated rating services and or publications should not be construed by a client or prospective client as a guarantee that he or she will experience a certain level of results if creative planning the company is engaged or continues to be engaged to provide investment advisory services, nor should it be construed as a current or past endorsement of company by any of its clients. Rankings published by magazines and others generally base their selections exclusively on information prepared and or submitted by the recognized advisor. Rankings are generally limited to participating advisors. The company never pays a fee to be considered for any ranking or recognition, but may purchase plaques or reprints to publicize rankings. More information regarding rankings and or accolades for creative planning can be found at creativeplanning.com/important disclosure information. Introduction. The financial services industry is broken. You may be surprised to hear this from someone who has made his living in the financial industry, but it's true. Financial advice and services are traditionally delivered through a system that requires relationships with a variety of professionals, an accountant, an attorney, an insurance agent, a financial advisor, a banker, and many others. These individuals rarely talk to one another, leaving you stuck in the middle, fighting to make sure everything is done correctly. The problem with this model is that your finances don't operate in a vacuum. Footnote. As if it didn't already sound terrible enough. The investment decisions you make with your portfolio are affected by income tax, estate planning, charitable giving, income needs, debt management strategies, business planning, financial independence goals, and many other factors. Of all these people acting on your behalf, only you see the full picture. How can others help you achieve your desired investment outcome if your desired outcome wasn't even considered before you started? To make things worse, the individuals sought for guidance in these matters are not necessarily legally required to meet the highest standard of care with your money. Instead, many professionals in the finance industry operate in a manner that's confusing to the average investor, or worse, purposefully misleading. Traditional brokerage firms can offer any product they think is appropriate for you, even if it arguably benefits their company more than it benefits you. You have insurance companies that package investment products inside annuities and insurance products that often generate huge commissions for their agents at your expense. And other firms can duly register and alternate at will between acting in a manner that meets the strictest responsibility for client care and in a manner that does not. Finally, independent firms, which are legally required to act in the client's best interest at all times, often lack the size, scale, and resources to effectively address the full scope of their client's needs. And who is stuck in the middle of all this mess? It's you, the average investor, having to make some of the most important decisions of your life. Asking questions like, how do I create a path that maximizes my financial opportunities, avoids potential pitfalls, and leads me to the right investments for my financial goals? How can I find the right guide to help lead me down this path? I started my career in this industry largely focused on estate planning, financial planning, and investment management advice, primarily for other advisors' clients. From this vantage point, I could see it all, and I didn't like much of what I saw. I saw that many advisors are excellent, but they work in conflicted environments. I saw advisors who would force their clients to sell all of their existing holdings before implementing a new strategy, regardless of the tax consequences for the client or the amount of damage done to the portfolio. I saw other advisors push their own products or a generic portfolio model on unsuspecting clients. I saw expensive insurance products sold instead of very low-cost investments that would have been better aligned with the client's goals. In short, people were often entrusting their life savings to a professional, only to later discover that the individual did more harm than good. I realized there had to be a better way of doing things. When I took over Creative Planning, a small independent investment firm in Overland Park, Kansas, I saw it as an opportunity to change the way financial advice is given in this country. I vowed to operate a firm that would not sell its own proprietary investment products, would create portfolios tailored to each client's needs, and could provide advice across key areas of a client's financial life, including taxes, law, financial planning, and investments. I am proud to say that we have not wavered from that commitment since I started in 2003. We are, however, able to do so much more for clients today than we ever dreamed of back then. Since I started at Creative Planning, the assets under management have grown to nearly $50 billion. We've been repeatedly recognized as a top wealth management firm by various media outlets, including the number one independent advisory firm in America by Barron in 2017, twice named the number one wealth management firm by CNBC in 2014 and 2015, and Forbes has listed Creative Planning number one on its ranking of the fastest growing independent firms in the country in 2016. This success is largely due to the incredible team we've built and their passion to deliver on our promises to our clients. As our team has grown, we've been able to add specialized services and expertise well beyond the reach of most other independent firms. An equally important reason for our tremendous growth is that average investors increasingly expect more from their advisors. Tony Robbins, for many years, has been a vocal advocate in promoting the fiduciary standard, helping to educate millions on the importance of working with an advisor who has a legal obligation to act in their client's best interest. In 2017, he and I wrote Unshakable, Your Financial Freedom Playbook, to answer some of the most pressing questions in investing today. If the past 17 years have taught me anything, it's that Americans are yearning for a clear and concise way to receive financial advice that is free from conflicts. They want a portfolio customized to their unique circumstances and goals. They're looking for a guide who can show them the path that leads to financial freedom. Creative Planning has been that guide for tens of thousands of families by creating customized plans, tailored portfolios, and comprehensively addressing any risks that might take them off their path to success. My goal in this book is to share my experiences with you and help eliminate the complexities you face in creating your own path. I look forward to being your guide, helping you to articulate your financial goals, avoid dangerous mistakes, and maximize the opportunities available to you along the journey. Together, we can chart your path to financial freedom.
Part 1. The Journey Ahead. Chapter 1. The Path to Freedom. Narrated by Tony Robbins. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
We all want to be truly free, free to do more of what we want, when we want, and share with those we love. Free to live with passion, with generosity, with gratitude, and with peace of mind. This is the promise of financial freedom. And it's not an amount of money. It's a state of mind. And regardless of your stage of life or your current financial picture, the goal of financial freedom can indeed be reached, yes, even in times of crisis. In fact, many of the greatest fortunes of humanity have been made during times of what are called maximum pessimism. Everyone has their own definition of financial freedom. For you, it might mean spending more time traveling, more time with your kids or your grandkids, or more time giving back to a meaningful cause. Maybe you desire to work because you want to, not because you have to. Whatever your definition of financial freedom, you might be wondering, is it truly possible? I can tell you after interviewing over 50 of the world's greatest financial minds, I can tell you with certainty there's indeed a path to get there. But there are clear rules that you must follow if you want to make it to the summit, and there are pitfalls and obstacles you've got to avoid, and there are numerous bad actors who can lead you astray with their self-interested advice. This book addresses all of these in detail. Becoming financially independent isn't rocket science, but there's also no magical black box to becoming financially free, despite those who would tell you otherwise. Your future self can't afford to climb without the groundwork of ropes and solid anchors to get you to the top of that financial mountain. And if you're committed to your personal vision of financial freedom, you must protect yourself, and you've got to participate in your own rescue. Now, depending upon where you are today, financial freedom might sound like a pipe dream, or you may be on the right track, but maybe not feeling a sense of freedom yet. You might be a millennial with burdensome student debt, or you might be a baby boomer who needs to play some serious catch-up. You may even be wealthy by most people's standards, yet have tremendous fear or uncertainty about losing what you have, especially in the world that seems to be topsy-turvy today. Regardless, this book will give you the proven tools, the strategies, and the peace of mind you need not only to achieve financial freedom, but also have a true sense of fulfillment along the way on the journey. It takes decades to become an overnight success. Let me fill you in on the biggest secret of financial freedom. You probably won't earn your way to it. For the vast majority, even those making great sums of money, saving enough to become financially secure is nearly impossible. Isn't it funny how the more we make, the more we seem to spend? And in thousands of conversations on the topic, most people say their plans involve hitting a financial home run, selling a business for a huge multiple, winning the lottery, getting a huge raise or promotion, or a surprise inheritance. But let's be honest, hope is not a strategy. There are simply way too many variables outside our control for many of these scenarios to fall perfectly in place. We must tap into the power that Albert Einstein called the eighth wonder of the world. And you know what it is, compound interest. You know, in The Tipping Point, Malcolm Gladwell describes the tipping point juncture as, quote, the moment of critical mass, the threshold, the boiling point, end quote. This is most certainly true when it comes to the power of compounding. So you want to be a millionaire? It's doable, especially if you start early. The chart shown in 1.1, which can be found in the bonus materials, is perhaps one of the most important charts you'll ever see. However, plan on seeing a bunch more of these in a financial book like this because they can guide you. A picture is worth a thousand words sometimes. This chart shows you that the amount of money you need to invest each year to have $1 million saved by age 65. This assumes a 7% earning rate and invested in a tax-deferred account like a 401k or an IRA. Now, if you start when you're really young, it's astonishing how small an amount of money you need to save in order to get to that $1 million by the time you retire. At age 20, you only need $3,217 a year to do it, or $272 a month. But if you wait to start till you're 50, you need to plunk down $37,191 a year, or $3,099 a month. Now, is this chart an oversimplification? Sure it is. There's no magical account where you get a 7% return year after year. In fact, from 2000 to 2009, a full 10 years, the S&P 500 produced a whopping 0% return. It's become known as the lost decade. But smart investors don't just own U.S. stocks. During my journey to financial freedom, I had the opportunity to sit down with so many brilliant minds, including investment legend Bert Malkiel, who authored that famous book, A Random Walk Down Wall Street. He explained that if during the last decade you were diversified in U.S. stocks, foreign stocks, emerging market stocks, bonds, and real estate, you would have averaged 6.7% annually, almost 7% during a period that included the tech bubble burst, 9/11, and the 2008 financial crisis. So it is doable. As I write this, we're in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic, and fear of global recessions are mounting, with the length and severity being beyond anyone's guess. The important thing to remember is that these economic winters, as I call them, are actually some of the best wealth-building opportunities of your life. If you can discipline your fear and manage your emotions, major market pullbacks can present the opportunity of a lifetime. Why? Because everything's on sale when people are afraid. And listen, fear doesn't last forever. Winter is always followed by spring. Here's an example. During the Great Depression, Joseph Kennedy Sr., this is John F. Kennedy's father, dramatically increased his fortune by investing heavily in real estate that was selling at a fraction of its previous value. Check this out. In 1929, Joseph Kennedy's fortune was estimated to be $4 million. That would be the equivalent of $59.6 million in today's U.S. dollars. But by 1935, just 6 years later, his $4 million ballooned to $180 million, or the equivalent of $3.36 billion today. See, are economic winters challenging? To be sure. However, winters don't last forever. As I just said, they're always followed by a spring, and even during winter, not every day is a snowy, dark blizzard. There's still sunny days in the middle of the winter, and they remind us that winter won't last forever. As you'll learn in this book, how you choose to navigate the continuously changing investment seasons, both emotionally and financially, is going to be crucial. So in order to make the summit of financial freedom and stay there and enjoy it, there are a lot of questions you got to answer. Here are six. First, what investments are available to you and which will be right for your goals? Second, what mix of investments will you include in your account or accounts and how will they be managed throughout the year? Third, What strategy will you use to legally minimize your taxes, since taxes are the largest single expense in your lifetime? 4, how will you eliminate excessive fees or unnecessary commissions, and by doing so, greatly increase your financial nest egg? Did you know saving 1% just on fees over a lifetime of investing will give you a decade more of income? 5, how will you navigate and even take advantage of market corrections and crashes? And finally, 6, how can you pick an advisor who's legally required to meet your highest standards of care for your money? And by the way, spoiler alert, most of them are not required by law to put you first. We'll talk about that a little bit later. These are the questions that my friend and co-author Peter Mallouk addresses in this incredibly important book. Peter has nearly 2 decades of experience running creative planning, which, by the way, if you want to reach them, they're at creativeplanning.com. It's a nearly $50 billion independent investment advisory firm that offers comprehensive wealth management services for thousands of families across the United States. In this book, Peter has generously taken his years of wisdom and hands-on experience and offered it up to anyone who wants to know what it truly takes to achieve financial security and freedom. But listen, having the tools necessary to achieve financial freedom and taking action are two different things. Execution trumps knowledge every day of the week. If achieving financial freedom isn't rocket science, why isn't it that we're not all living in the most prosperous time in history and experiencing it at the highest level? Yet so many people fail to secure even the basic levels of financial security. Frighteningly, 60% of Americans don't even have $1,000 saved for retirement, and less than 40% say they can handle a $500 emergency. We're a nation of consumers, but if we're to collectively prosper, we must make the shift to becoming owners. Listen, many Americans own iPhones, but why don't they own Apple? Many Americans find Amazon boxes on their doorstep every day, but why don't they own the powerhouse retailer? Nothing prohibits us, regardless of our current socioeconomic status, from benefiting from the power of innovative capitalism. Anyone with just a few dollars can own a piece of the top U.S. companies and be an owner of arguably the most prosperous and profitable economy in world history. Moving beyond. The relationship we have with money is undoubtedly an emotional one. The strategies and information we all need to achieve financial freedom are readily available. So why is it that so many are wandering aimlessly, financially stressed, or unaware of the path forward, or that one even exists? And why are so many people financially successful, yet entirely unfulfilled and sometimes even emotionally bankrupt? The reason is the worst four-letter word that anyone can imagine. F-E-A-R, you know it, fear. Fear is that invisible force that keeps us from creating the life we truly deserve. It's the greatest obstacle on the path, and left unchecked, it encourages us to make incredibly poor investment decisions. As you'll learn in the sections ahead, our brain is hardwired to focus on what's wrong, on what can harm or threaten our way of life. We often want certainty above all else, but guess what? Becoming a great investor involves embracing uncertainty. Becoming financially free is certainly about having the right strategy, but if you don't have the mastery of your mind, your strategy will likely fail due to your own misguided interventions, i.e. selling during volatile times or putting your cash under your mattress. Repetition is the mother of skill. In 2014, I wrote Money Master the Game, which was the compilation of everything I'd learned from years of interviews with true money masters like Carl Icahn, Ray Dalio, and Jack Bogle. Around the same time, Peter wrote a book called The 5 Mistakes Every Investor Makes and How to Avoid Them. 2 years later, Peter and I wrote Unshakable, Your Guide to Financial Freedom, as a way for people to truly understand how markets work and remove the fear around corrections and crashes. Now we're in the middle of the Great Pause, where the world has come to a halt, and there will surely be winners and losers when we emerge normal life again. Compared to the previous books, Peter takes a much deeper dive into the fundamentals of how to build your plan and win the game. This book is about mastering the strategies of investing, not just the concepts. But I've also included 2 chapters on self-mastery. In chapter 3, we explore the understanding of the 6 human needs that each one of us has and how they influence your path in life, business, and money. The insights we unpack will transform the quality of your life. In chapter 12, we'll tackle the issues of why those with financial abundance are often still not happy, and how can you have a feeling of abundance today, not just someday when you hit a specific number. Each of us is prone to live in suffering states, fear, frustration, anger, overwhelm, stress. And if we surrender to an undirected mind, we'll live with that pain. We have to learn to rescue our thoughts from the hostage taker between our own ears. And in doing this, you can experience the true promise of real wealth, and that is a life filled with joy, happiness, generosity, excitement, and peace of mind. If you've read my previous books, these two chapters may offer some repetition. However, the principles are worth repeating. I've learned from my own mentors that repetition is the master of skill, or the mother of skill, if you prefer. You don't become LeBron James or Steph Curry by shooting a few free throw shots during practice. Even though they know how to make a free throw, they still shoot thousands of practice shots a week, so it's embedded in their nervous system so they can execute under pressure. They don't just understand it intellectually, it's in their body, and that's the path to mastery. So as you listen, look for important nuances in how these principles are showing up in your life and in your relationships today. When we see a movie or hear a song that we've heard before, we're in a different place than the first time we heard it. And often we get something new out of it. I suggest the same is true here. Course correct. We're living in a time when our fear is magnified and exploited by both the media and social media. Add a pandemic to the mix, and fear becomes heightened to an extraordinarily unhealthy level. Tidal waves of information hit us daily with the goal of getting our attention, hence the term clickbait. Good news takes a back seat to the latest tragedy, threat, or swarm of murder hornets that are coming to a town near you. The fear part of our brain is continuously stoked and our anxiety levels are at record highs. But let's face the truth. If we don't learn to take control of our fear, to master our mind, we'll never truly execute on the great principles in this book. Remember, courage doesn't mean you don't experience fear. It means you consistently take action in spite of that fear. You move forward in spite of the fear. You may listen to this book and get some great information, but never take the steps to achieve the goals that you and your family deserve. But I know that isn't you, or you wouldn't be listening right now. If you purchased this book and you're still listening, I know you're one of those people I call the few who do versus the many who talk. So the first step in taking our minds back from the tyranny of terror is to recalibrate our perspective. So I'm going to pass the baton for this portion now to Peter Mallouk, and I'm thrilled for you to dive into this next chapter. You'll have a full appreciation of the incredible times that we're experiencing right now and the exponential, unimaginable future we have in store if we can arm ourselves with the right education and learn to conquer our fears and take action instead. Are you ready? Let the journey begin.
Chapter 2, The World is Better Than You Think. On what principle is it that when we see nothing but improvement behind us, we are to expect nothing but deterioration before us? Thomas Babington Macaulay. London, 1848. It was a beautiful morning. That was until Queen Victoria opened her balcony door at Buckingham Palace. A stench quickly invaded her nostrils and overwhelmed her to the point of nausea. In what came to be known as the Great Stink, London had been completely overcome with the gut-wrenching, oppressive smell of human and animal feces. For the better part of the previous 50 years, 2.5 million London residents had been dumping waste directly into the streets and the River Thames. The situation had finally reached a proverbial tipping point. There were now over 200,000 steaming cesspits beneath the city's homes and businesses that in futility were routinely shoveled by night soilmen. Cholera breakouts became common as sewage overflowed into cisterns and rivers, contaminating the drinking water and causing all manner of sickness. Survival was the goal. We all seem to wish for a return to the good old days, when in fact, let's face it, the good old days weren't all that good. 400 years ago, nearly 30% of European population was wiped out from a single disease, the bubonic plague. Just 200 years ago, during the time of the stink bomb in London, 45% of children died before reaching the age of 5. Having your children survive to adulthood in Victorian England was a relative coin flip. Imagine the morale of a society that routinely lost nearly half of its offspring. And we don't need to go as far back as Victorian England. Just 100 years ago, 20 million people were killed in the 4 years of World War I. That same year, the Spanish flu tore through Europe, infecting 500 million people, one-third of the world's population, and killing over 50 million. Okay, I promise I'm done with this tour through depressing events in human history. I recall this history only because it's important for us to recalibrate our brains to the blessings of the here and now. Our brains trick us into loving narratives of nostalgia, but these narratives contain a real flaw. They rarely capture the whole picture. History is riddled with war, disease, and famine, and these past times are brutally sobering when compared to our present day. Even with modern pandemics, like the COVID-19 coronavirus, humanity's prognosis is vastly superior to that of previous generations. Today, only about 4% of children worldwide die by the age of 5, and overall pediatric and maternal health is at an all-time high. We haven't had a major war in a generation, and most illness can be treated with modern medicine. Furthermore, sanitation is greatly improved, for which I am grateful. We struggle to remember this because we are often limited by our day-to-day experiences. Not only is our view of history mistakenly labeled a golden age, our view of the future is mistakenly pessimistic. Dr. Hans Rosling, the late scholar of international health, wrote in his book Factfulness that every group of people thinks the world is more frightening, more violent, and more hopeless. In short, more dramatic than it really is. Despite the facts, we're predisposed to a deterministic fate of doom and gloom. This darkened point of view is often apparent when I sit down with people regarding their personal finances. When we are imagining their future and mapping out their plans, the conversation will take a sharp turn from optimistic saving for a comfortable retirement to a quick cash survivalist mentality. They reveal a fatalistic view of society coming unraveled, supported, I'm sure, by websites and YouTube videos committed to perpetuating that narrative. Nobody knows what the future has in store, but a look at our most recent past should allay our worries. In his book, The Rational Optimist, Matt Ridley waxes eloquent on the rapid acceleration of human progress and expansion over the past 50 years. In 2005, compared to 1955, the average human being on planet Earth earned nearly 3 times as much money adjusted for inflation, ate 1/3 more calories of food, buried 1/3 as many of her children, and could expect to live 1/3 longer. She was less likely to die as a result of war, murder, childbirth, accidents, tornadoes, flooding, famine, whooping cough, tuberculosis, malaria, diphtheria, typhus, typhoid, measles, smallpox, scurvy, or polio. She was less likely at any given age to get cancer, heart disease, or stroke. She was more likely to be literate and have finished school. She was more likely to own a telephone, a flush toilet, a refrigerator, and a bicycle. All this during a half century when the population more than doubled. By any standard, an astonishing human achievement. The antidote. Consider the 5 charts that follow to be the visual antidote for our susceptibility to worrying about the future. Based on research that charted spending, life expectancy, global well-being, poverty, and education, these graphs are comforting reminders of where our world is headed. As a father, I am hopeful about the future of humanity and the quality of life my children and grandchildren will enjoy. And as we will get to shortly, as an investor, I'm licking my chops at the opportunities ahead. I suspect you will too. Figure 2.1 shows the precipitous drop in how much of our income we use to survive. In other words, we are living at the peak of disposable income. College tuition, Disney cruises, luxury cars that drive themselves, date nights out of the town, movie theaters with giant leather recliners, and of course, our ability to save for a comfortable retirement. These are all relatively new phenomena when viewed through the arc of history. Among many other factors, not having to spend every dollar we make on the bare necessities has dramatically increased our global population's sense of happiness and well-being. No surprise there. We are now free to move beyond survival in our own hierarchy of needs and begin asking the more existential questions around purpose, what it means to be fulfilled, and how we want to spend our precious time. Without the day-to-day struggle of figuring out how to pay for housing and food, we're able to spend more time on what matters and be happier doing it. Figure 2.3 is astonishing. Life expectancies around the world are continually on the rise. Get this. Someone born this year is projected to have a life expectancy 3 months longer than someone born in 2019. Earlier in my career, when my senior clients faced serious health challenges, they often asked for hospice planning or quotes on the price of end-of-life care. Now they are looking to stay alive as long as they can and are quick to look for experimental treatments or the latest breakthroughs in global medicine. These clients know that the longer they can stay alive, the more likely there will be an innovation that can help their condition. Figure 2.4 is perhaps the most eye-opening. Assuming you aren't a royal descendant, you probably don't have to go back too far in your family tree to find lives defined by struggle and survival. Until the 1950s, the vast majority of human existence on this planet was experienced in extreme poverty. Extreme poverty is defined as living on less than $2 a day adjusted for inflation. In the 1980s, 44% of the world's population still met the definition of extreme poverty. Now, a mere 4 decades later, fewer than 10% of the world is living in such dire conditions. What changed? Technological and economic growth have pulled hundreds of millions of people up into the middle class. Want more good news? The World Bank estimates that we can be completely rid of extreme poverty within 20 years. Finally, education is the great equalizer. If families are focused on survival, children will often have to drop out of school early to work. Children forced to stack bricks, shepherd animals, and lug heavy jugs of water for hours each day begin to view education as an unattainable luxury. But if economic forces take hold, children can be released from survival tasks and spend more time in school. The longer children are able to stay in school, the better chance they have at building the skill set needed to overcome their circumstances and pursue new opportunities. Education can allow children to get a better job, earn more money, send their own children to school, and end the cycle of poverty in their family once and for all. Chorus of chaos. So with all the good news, why doesn't it feel as if we are making progress? Why does it feel as if we are swimming in this tumultuous tide? In part, I think we have the news to thank for this. Your brain has one primary function, survival. It's designed to focus on what is wrong, what is dangerous, and what threatens your way of life. News producers know this, and with a steady flow of fear, crises, countdowns, and suspense, they get you addicted to staying tuned in. To get viewers, shows often over-dramatize events. Many events are packaged into stories with a tagline and a three-step story arc. Often they are accompanied by what screenwriters call putting a clock on it. Footnote, thanks to my brother Mark, a screenwriter, for sharing this concept with me. For free. Just as a movie will create tension and a sense of urgency with a ticking clock, if Sandra Bullock doesn't get to the space station in 90 minutes, she'll get hit by space junk and die. Footnote, this is a reference to the 2003 blockbuster Gravity, and not to be confused with, if Sandra Bullock doesn't help disarm a bomb on this bus before it drops below a certain speed, everyone will die, which would reference the 1994 blockbuster Speed. So too, the media match many of these stories with a clock in the lower right-hand corner of the screen. Tick, tick, tick. When the media depict finance and the economy, they employ these same tactics. Just think of terms like the sequester and the fiscal cliff. These terms are developed to invoke a sense of danger in the news stories that are far from life and death. For a recent example, recall the clock winding down, minute by minute, really, we need by the minute, to the 2019 debt ceiling limit. What happened when the clock struck zero? Politicians compromised, papers were signed, and the debt ceiling was raised with little fanfare. Similarly, it seems that no matter in which direction the market is heading, there is always a chorus of vocal fatalists that dominate the financial channels. Of course, this is nothing new. The financial media have been selling fear dating back to the market panic of 1907. Many books have been written about the inaccuracy of the media's more recent financial predictions, such as the 1970s stagflation, the 1987 crash, the tech bubble, which took hysteria to an entirely new level since it accompanied the rise of 24-hour televised news, the 2008 crisis, the European debt crisis, the 2019 debt ceiling, and the list goes on. So what do we have to show for such mania? Investors panic unnecessarily and make preventable mistakes. Many retirement plans were compromised when investors sold everything and cashed in during the 2008 financial crisis, the government shutdown, and the debt ceiling talks. These sellers suffered permanent losses by missing out on gains that occurred once the crisis subsided. In other words, they took the elevator down, got off, and missed the ride back up, usually to new highs. And what about the toll on their physical health? Investors get completely stressed out by financial discussions in the media. In Financial News and Client Stress, 2012, Dr. John Grable at the University of Georgia and Dr. Sonia Britt at Kansas State University show that an individual's stress level increases substantially while viewing financial news, regardless of what the news was about. When the market is down, people worry about their accounts. When the market is up, they are upset that they're not more aggressively positioned. In fact, 67% of people watching financial news showed increased stress levels. Even when the financial news was positive, 75% exhibited signs of increased stress. I am not suggesting there is not real volatility in market corrections, and we will explore more how to navigate these times later. But let's look at reality. Every U.S. bear market has given way to a bull market. Every economic contraction has given way to economic expansion. As I write this, investors are grappling with a bear market brought on by a global pandemic. However, as with every bear market in history, the market will fully recover and go back to its normal upward trajectory. But you wouldn't know it watching the news. A large part of the issue with financial media is that many people misunderstood the purpose for its existence. Media are businesses, and businesses exist to make a profit. The primary purpose of media is not to inform, it is to make money. Media outlets make money by selling advertisements, and the news channels can charge higher prices for advertising placement if they have high ratings. Because of this, the primary purpose of any news outlet is to get as many viewers as possible. They call them eyeballs. To tune in and to get those viewers to watch for as long as possible. The rough math is this. More viewers equals higher prices for advertising, equals larger profit, equals happier shareholders. On the Weather Channel, nothing gets more viewers than coverage of a hurricane or tornado. But most of the time, weather reporting is pretty boring. Partly sunny, 30% chance of rain, possible thunderstorms. These headlines don't draw in viewers. Similarly, there's often not much to report in the world of financial news. The market goes up, the market goes down, companies go public with an initial public offering. This really isn't revolutionary stuff. To make things interesting, media reporting often spins average stories about the dip in one day of the stock market into tales of financial crisis, but there is often little to no effect on the long-term success of the market, which is why Figure 2.6 is one of my favorites. It's aptly titled, Human Innovation Always Trumps Fear. On the graph, you'll see that there's barely enough space to pack in all the crisis headlines going back to 1896. And what does the market do? The market shrugs, and it goes on to make new highs, rewarding long-term investors. The world is better than you think. Who cares? Although it's easy to forget sometimes, a share is not a lottery ticket. It's part ownership of a business. Peter Lynch. If a business does well, the stock eventually follows. Warren Buffett. People often ask, what makes the stock market move up or down? Some are confident that they know the answer, but they are almost always wrong. Investors often cite one of the following as being the primary driver of stock prices: unemployment, housing, economic policy, monetary policy, the strength of the dollar, consumer confidence, retail sales, and interest rates. All are popular choices. In fact, the stock market cares about only one thing above all else: anticipated earnings, i.e., future profits. If companies make more money, their shares become more valuable and their share prices eventually rise. The stock price is simply a reflection of a company's earning power. Everything else is noise. Assume for a moment that you're going to buy a sandwich shop. What do you care about? As a newly minted small business owner, the most important factor you care about is anticipated earnings. If you buy the shop, you're doing so because you believe the profits earned will justify the purchase price with a good return. To arrive at this conclusion, you would likely look at every factor that could affect your ability to make money from the sandwich shop. For example, if interest rates are low, you could make lower payments on your loan, thus making the shop more profitable. In this case, interest rates matter only because they affect your anticipated earnings. Commodity prices will also likely matter, as oil, cheese, ham, and bread are all commodities that vary in price. If oil prices go up, you will pay more to have the food delivered to your shop every day. Rising food costs will also increase your expenses. While low interest rates could increase your bottom line, increases in commodity prices could eat away at your bottom line, and both affect your anticipated earnings. Consumer confidence matters too, because if consumers think their financial world is collapsing, they will forgo your $8 sandwich and make the kids a PB&J at home. That will drive down sales, which would lower your earnings. You get the idea. Note, however, the important word here is anticipated. No one cares about yesterday's earnings. Let's go back to that sandwich shop you have your eye on. You're talking to the owner, reviewing his financials, and you can see he made $100,000 each of the previous 3 years by selling about 20,000 sandwiches a year. This sounds pretty stable, so you're thinking about offering him $200,000 for his business, knowing that you can make $100,000 per year once you pay off the debt it takes to buy it. By year three, you'll be back in the black. But you're too smart to take these sales at face value. You notice that the owner has sold 5,000 of his sandwiches each year to a large corporate client and that the client just went out of business. If you take those sales out of the equation, the sandwich shop would be much less profitable and the anticipated earnings of the store would be lower than first estimated. As a savvy negotiator, you would no longer offer the same price for the shop. You're focused on the only thing that really matters: anticipated earnings. The bottom line is this: all of the other factors in the economy matter only because people buying and selling stocks are trying to determine how the changes in various indicators, unemployment, interest rates, and so on, will ultimately affect a company's anticipated earnings. No one cares how much healthcare companies made in the past. They want to know how new healthcare reform laws will affect the future earnings of these companies. No one cares if Starbucks made $1 million or $1 billion last year. They want to know if their earnings will be hurt now that McDonald's is selling gourmet coffee. No one cares how much money General Dynamics made selling military supplies to the government in the past. They want to know if worldwide military conflicts will persist, driving up future sales. That's why when the 2008 U.S. bear market was in full swing, investors bought Walmart stock. The thought was that Walmart's anticipated earnings would increase as consumers scaled down to buy everything as inexpensively as possible. The same reasoning drove Nordstrom's stock price down. McDonald's stock held up relatively well because investors figured consumers would want to eat out on the cheap. The same logic drove down the stock price of higher-end restaurants like the Cheesecake Factory. And of course, companies selling alcohol did just fine because people tend to drink when they're depressed and when they're happy, which is why alcohol is considered recession-proof. Another interesting fact: the stock market as a whole tends to move up well before a recession is over. The market doesn't care what's going on today. It's anticipating the earnings of companies in the future. If the stock market drops, it's because investors believe future earnings will get worse. If the market moves up, it's because investors believe the economic climate is changing to enable companies to become more profitable in the future. Footnote. Of course, it can get a little more complicated than that because investors will always be comparing their future earnings against earnings they can get elsewhere. For example, if the 10-year Treasury is paying 10%, that big swishing sound you hear might be money flying out of the stock market and into the bond market. Of course, So many variables go into predicting anticipated earnings, and the market is not always right in the short run, although it is almost always right in the long run. For example, you could buy the perfect sandwich shop under perfect conditions and have a multitude of surprises derail your profits, like rising crime in the area, unforeseen road construction blocking access to your shop, or a new fad diet that prohibits any consumption of bread. And we can have a nearly perfect economic environment, and someone can fly a plane into a building and turn everything upside down overnight. However, unlike your sandwich store, which can lose all of its value, the stock market itself is resilient. Throughout history, no matter how bad things have appeared, the top U.S. companies, the S&P 500, have ultimately found a way to not only make money, but to make more money than they did before, every single time. And as always, the stock market continues to follow the earnings. Where in the world are we headed? It's my opinion, and the opinion of many experts, that humanity's best days are ahead of us. As we've already heard in this chapter, humanity is certainly trending upward. It is also why this could potentially be one of the best times in history to be an investor. Human progress is an unstoppable force. Our future is not linear, it's exponential. Case in point, in 1975, a 24-year-old engineer named Steven Sasson developed the world's first self-contained digital camera while working at Kodak. It weighed 8 pounds and took 23 seconds to shoot a 0.01 megapixel photo that could be viewed only on a large television. His bosses were unimpressed. They were convinced no one would ever want to look at the pictures on a television set, Sasson told the New York Times. Sasson kept plugging away, and each year the resolution of his photos doubled. Blurry became fractionally less blurry. But it was still not impressive to the executives, who failed to understand the power of compounding. Double something 10 times, it's 1,000 times better. Double it 20 times, it's 1,000,000 times better. Double it 30 times, it's 1,000,000,000 times better. This is how technology works. This is how pictures taken on your iPhone now rival that of a professional photographer. It took 18 years after Sasson invented the digital technology for Kodak to pivot from film to digital. By that point, it was far too late. Companies like Sony and Apple were quicker to embrace the technology and got out ahead of their competitors. The rest is history. Right now, we're on the cusp of many transformative exponential technologies. They may seem to the untrained eye to be the equivalent of an early-stage digital photograph, but make no mistake, they're changing the game for investors and, in fact, humanity itself. For example, we've learned more about the human body in the last 20 years than in all of human history combined. That knowledge is being translated into dramatic advancements in tools available to fight the spread of disease and radically reimagine healthcare. Advancements in
gene. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.